session, we're in conversation with Mr. Naga Nandakodituakku, Dr. Dinesha Samararatna, and Dr. Pratibha Mahanamaheva, all attorneys at law of the Republic. My first question in this round is to Dr. Mahanamaheva. Dr. Mahanamaheva, something that we also see in the new interim report that has been released is the fact that certain words seem to be missing. For example, the word republic. Now, we know that the 1972 constitution was the first republican constitution, and the 1978 constitution is a second republican constitution. So is the new constitution we're looking at going to be the third republican constitution? What are the implications of this word republic, really? Because that word seems to be missing from the interim report. Your time starts now.
Before that, clearly mention whatever the report schedules are there. But Sri Lanka main political party, United National Party, their proposals are not there. So the people will believe this constitution is a brainchild of UNP. I may be wrong. The responsibility had taken by Jathika Helorume and all the other parties. Why they failed to give their proposals? Those who are advocating this. That is only one comment I like to make. So even still not late, they can add this. Otherwise people will think all the other political parties are giving their proposals, the major party is not giving. Okay, doesn't matter. Now you asked a question, you have dropped the word republic. Now in Australia, I can remember, they had a referendum for this when John Howard was the prime minister. They are with still Queen Elizabeth is the head of the state. They want to go for a republic, but finally John Howard government failed. So the people mandate. So even these questions, I like not only my view to get. And until 1972, what happened? Our final court was not Supreme Court of Sri Lanka, Privy Council. So this republic word is where once again, I think nations or anyone may not disagree for this. But Sri Lanka and the Republic, what is the legal issue finally? You are making it. So once you drop a word, you have to give some justification. What is the real reason? Otherwise people may have other versions. And then you start the debate. And also the word unitary. Now I would like to say, main politicians are saying, if there is a, you know, disagreement between Sinhala and Tamil one, the Sinhala one give the priority. But in this constitution, nothing like that. Can you show me anything? Any other legislation in Sri Lanka, final sentence, any contradiction, controversy between Sinhala and Tamil, Sinhala one remain. Okay, I like for the new constitution if you can put that clause. My argument is that all these government politicians promoting, advocating one thing. Don't worry. If anything, Sinhala and Tamil, the word for unitary, if anything happens, the Sinhala word get the priority. I like if that clause also put to the new constitution. Simple. We should not argue like that. So we are not honestly giving this type of perception. So that's why these issues had created. So rather than creating any doubt, those who are agree, those who are disagree, now start the debate in one platform. So experts are there. I mean both sides experts are there. Rather than politicians. All these experts come to one platform and then discuss. The matter can be solved.
Right. Thank you very much. So, Dr. Mahanamaheva, in a sense, what you're saying is that in the event of any inconsistency between texts, there must be a clause stating that the text of one language must prevail. Right. Thank you very much. Dr. Dinesh Samararatna, the apex court of Sri Lanka is a supreme court which handles not only cases pertaining to fundamental rights, constitutional affairs, appeals, but the new interim report suggests the appointing of a constitutional court to hear matters of constitutional significance exclusively. What is the significance of this move, and how do you view this moving forward?
Yeah. So, Sonali, I see this as a progressive development.
Right.
Particularly if you want to strengthen the constitution as a supreme law of the country. And to backtrack, as Mr. Kodithuwakku mentioned earlier, except perhaps the Solberry constitution, the 72 constitution and the 78 constitution have not allowed the constitution to be the supreme law. Rather, it has recognized legislative supremacy over the other two organs. I mean, we can talk about the judiciary later on if questions do come up. So if we want to strengthen the judiciary as an independent arbiter of the meaning of the constitution, establishing a constitutional court is a progressive development. Both the subcommittee report on the judiciary and the interim report proposes a constitutional court. And what is envisaged is that relevant nominations will be made to this court for matters relating to the interpretation of the constitution, interpretation and protection of fundamental rights, and also to interpret and resolve disputes between provincial councils and the center. Now, Dr. Mahanam have mentioned this question about how the issue as to how you deal with inconsistent language in law.
Right.
The need for a clause recognizing Sinhala as the prevailing language in case of a dispute was more significant in the absence of judicial review of legislation. But if you do have judicial review of legislation as is being proposed via the constitutional court, that is one way of addressing this issue.
Right.
And also to go back to this question of whether Sri Lanka is to be unitary, united, etc. The interim report identifies two words, one Sinhala and one Tamil.
Sure.
Ekya Rajya and Orumitha Nadu.
Yeah.
And it goes on to clarify what these two words ought to mean. And at least in two different places, the interim report specifies that Sri Lanka should remain one undivided and indivisible country.
Sure, but for the word unitary to be taken out of the equation. That is suggested in the interim report itself.
Well, they have identified the issues that ought to be discussed, and they do not propose that the word unitary needs to be taken out. Right? Sri Lanka is a free, sovereign and independent republic, which is an Ekya Rajya or Orumitha Nadu, and then they go on to explain what those two words ought to mean. It means a state which is undivided and indivisible, which
right.
is also the meaning
there
of
itself. Unitary. It says the classical definition of the English term unitary state has undergone change. The English term unitary state will not be appropriate for Sri Lanka. That suggestion is made. Now, my further question to you, Dr. Dinesha, is, now, with regard to these words, there is so much of debate in the country, and some of the debate is not really healthy because there is miscommunication, misinformation all over. So how do we go about progressively having a healthy conversation? I mean, people from all walks of life, people from all stratas of society are debating on the semantics of the words in all three languages. So how do you look at this?
So like I said earlier, Sonali, ultimately we have to debate on the substance of what is being proposed. So the concerns about secession, for instance, need to be evaluated vis-a-vis the substance that is being proposed. As I see it, as I mentioned earlier, there are several sections in the interim report which specifically talk about the need to guarantee that Sri Lanka continues to be an undivided and indivisible country. And if you look at specific proposals, for instance, the Constitutional Court, which is at the center, will determine the meaning of law. So provincial council statutes, legislation passed by the center, will be ultimately interpreted and reviewed by the judiciary at the center. In the case of an emergency, the president continues to enjoy the power of taking over even a provincial council. And the constitution remains supreme, not a legislative body. So the constitution shall be interpreted by the judiciary. And these are the mechanisms by which we continue to ensure that the country exists as a whole. If you have any further questions, I can clarify them.
All right, thank you very much.
I like to just mention one idea.
Sure.
This is where the present constitution article 2, the Republic of Sri Lanka is a unitary state. Now in the present Tamil word, if you can find out, now the present constitution is Orimithanadu or different word? My simple question I am asking. Article 2, the Republic of Sri Lanka is a unitary. Sri Lanka veki Rajya. Now what is the word in the present constitution, Tamil word for unitary state? Is it Orumithanadu? If not, there is an issue.
Thank you for your opinion, Dr. Mahana Maheva. The final question to Mr. Kodithuwakku in this round. Given the fact that Sri Lanka's legal system is riddled with delays, and there are issues pertaining to the process, the expediency or lack thereof, how do you think we need to look positively at some of the positive suggestions made, especially in the subcommittee reports of the Constitutional Assembly, example with regard to fundamental rights? Don't you think you're being a little pessimistic about this whole constitutional reform process?
You know, this is one reason why people went to Geneva on the 1st of October 2015, I think, if the current date is right. There was a UN resolution against the judiciary here. They say the people of Sri Lanka have no confidence and in the absence of accountability process in the justice system. The fact remains, it's true. Because what I say, every day if you go to Supreme Court and the Court of Appeal, that's the area that I practice, you will see every day about 10, 12, a lot of number, series of cases filed. That's only one or two cases only, I mean, terminated on one day, maybe one or two. So it's case, a volume of cases piling up and up. So there has to be a process, accountability process. What I suggest. For example, today, I was in the Supreme Court. For two matters, the whole day is gone. All the other matters, postponed.
So, Mr. Kodithuwakku, this is exactly why we need reform to speed up.
No, what I say,
things.
The reform in the sense, there has to be accountability process, very clear accountability
but
process.
But we have systems in place already, don't we?
We don't have. We don't have a kind of, case management system in this country. If there's a case management system in this country, we all need not go to courthouse in the 10 o'clock in the morning. If there's a management system, the first day, one judge will allocate, there will be a management hearing. This is how the other countries practice law. So at the management hearing, they fix a specific time and allocate, time scale for whatever both parties. And people will attend court only in that particular time. Need not go to 10 o'clock, maybe 2 o'clock, or maybe 1 o'clock or whatever. So people will not be allowed to waste time. And here you see what happened in this country. There is no such specific methodology here. People spend hours and hours and hours. Others people wait in the whole day in the courthouse and go home and taking only a date. This has to be stopped somewhere. There has to be an accountability process for the Chief Justice and the President of the Court of Appeal and the head of the President of the, I don't know who the person, the High Court, either President or head of the High Court.
The JSC, judicial.
Yeah, so there has to be a system, and the person in charge of the these areas has to take the full responsibility. If the, for example, in the Supreme Court, if the Chief Justice failed to make sure that particular case filed on that particular day and has to be finished within a specific time scale, if that is not done, then the Chief Justice should be removed automatically. That has to be a process. If that is his duty, and the Court of Appeal, the Supreme Court, High Court, all there has to be a system. Unfortunately, there is no such system in this country. That is why people suffer. That is why all these delays. So this has to be dealt with, and unfortunately, it is not being addressed yet.
So you're saying that the necessary stakeholders aren't doing their job. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I didn't get your question.
Are you saying then that the relevant stakeholders are not doing their job? This comes within the purview of the Minister of Justice.
Not really the Minister of Justice. He cannot intervene there. I mean, now that is why I say I emphasize the fact there has to be an accountability process which is not there in this country. This has to be introduced. Otherwise, if I become the Chief Justice for that period, I just deal with it and go home. And the volume goes up and up and up. I am not bothered. That is not the way it should be done. That there has to be an accountability process. So this
right.
problem
so
has to be
dealt with. So you are dissatisfied with the existing
processes?
No,
I am not satisfied at all.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Kodithuwakku. Nadeem, you had a question. Start off with you.
Yes. Mr. Kodithuwakku, I'll come back to that, what you're saying. Given that dissatisfaction, given the need for an accountability process for case management, time management in the judiciary. Given that need, don't you think that this is the ideal moment? You have a relatively open constitutional reform process that is currently underway. Don't you think that this is the ideal moment to get involved in that process and to accomplish these goals?
That's what I say. I put forward in my proposals all this. Even that particular document not even acknowledged by this particular committee.
The public consultations committee.
Because this is what I say. There are certain areas that has to be dealt with, as my learned friend said. They are not least bothered. For example, judicial review is a must. And the judiciary should be given the right place. Legislature cannot claim supremacy. In this country, supremacy, that the sovereignty is in the people.
Can
the
I
people
interrupt for a moment? Now the committee, if so transparent, why they have dropped his proposals?
Dr. Samaratna, is this concerning to you that Mr. Kodithuwakku's proposals have not been included in the report?
Well, if he has submitted,
they're not
it
bad proposals. They are good proposals.
I
you agree that they are good proposals?
I haven't seen the proposals.
The proposal for the in the interest of the people
no,
of this country.
In the general sense of what he's saying,
so
case management,
etc. I am not. So on the question of access to justice, that's something that I'm also concerned about. I think 2 weeks ago, a sectoral Parliament sectoral committee said it takes 17 years for a case to go through our criminal justice system, and that's a very long time for someone to wait as a victim or as a accused in order to see the conclusion of a trial. We have very, very serious issues related to access to justice. While of course the judiciary perhaps needs to improve in how it manages the cases, we must not forget that the judiciary is not the only stakeholder. We also have to look at how the legal profession represents clients and look at our responsibility in this area. So this is a concern that has to be addressed regardless of whether we have a new constitution or not. Just to go back to the Public Representations Committee, as per their own report, they identify that they describe rather that they have accepted submissions from over 2,500 persons, oral and written representation, and that further over 800 representations were made via email, 150 by way of fax messages, 60 by telephone messages, and 700 representations by post or handed over at the office. So I don't know what happened to your
representation. I really sent it by email from London. When I returned to Sri Lanka, I furnished another document. Same thing. I talked to them and furnished another copy. But still, because there are the very serious changes made.
Yeah, yeah. Now, a list was given.
Yeah.
Now, who is selecting this is the best proposal, this is not best? How we are demarcating.
Dr. Samaratnam, there are some questions regarding,
yes.
I mean, I have some questions.
And now I've been fast turned into an apologist for everything that they are criticizing. But yes, let's go for it.
So I'll pose this question to you.
Yes.
You don't have to be an apologist. I'll ask you
I'm
this question
an
as an academic.
Yes.
Do you feel that the Public Representations Committee, in that entire process of how the proposals were accepted, who proposals were accepted,
yep,
from which proposals, do you see a lack of intellectual discipline,
right,
in this process?
So I'm not an apologist, but I am an optimist, I must confess. Like I said, if you look at the consultation processes that were undertaken in the constitutions that were proposed and adopted in the past, this is by far the most accessible process that was adopted. If you recall, the committee was appointed, I think, in January 2016. The report was published in April 2016. That's 4 months. And I know that this committee ensured that they did go through these all the proposals that were made. In fact, they traveled to all 25 districts, right? And now, Dr. Mahanamheva raises a valid question. How do you represent such a wide array of submissions that are made? It's not possible to do that except to compile them in a file. Mm. But if you go through the report, the committee tries its best to distill the differences of opinion. And in that, for me, is the strength in this report. It makes certain recommendations and then it identifies that there were disagreements. Excuse me. From those recommendations that were made. But, and they also, of course, they had their own point of view and say, this seems to be the general consensus. Sorry, excuse me. So, that's, I think, as an optimist, you could use that in trying to understand how the polity thinks. And there is something in this report for everyone. It does represent the spectrum of political opinion on most of the issues that we are debating today.
Dr. Mahanamheva, does that sort of assure you? Does it give you some assurance on?
I think
on the quality of the report.
Yeah, my main issue still whether this is a UNP-oriented report. I mean,
but why do you say?
Well, if the main political party in Sri Lanka not taking the responsibility to put their proposals, now where are their proposals then? I mean, I am making a point not to criticize this, to make it a more smooth way and present to people. So they are representing 38 lakhs or 40 lakhs of people. Whether UNPA's ideas are there, maybe with the 700 or 800. So people are more, you know, taking the leadership rather than the political party. So no need to create doubts. Right. Okay. Now, rather than debating this, we will come to the interim report or the draft constitution like 1997 October or year 2001. Then we can start the debate in a more fresh and accurate way. I mean, we are just looking things.
Mr. Paritho.
And still they say, 1 minute, to go for a referendum. And even people can go to the Supreme Court, Naga.
Yeah.
Once you present the draft constitution or even whatever you mean as a bill.
Yeah.
Will can't Dr. Dinesh, we go to that stage now? Now, this has already completed. I mean, we can't take the responsibility, but yeah, the next stage, are we looking for a next stage or it's there, you clearly explain. This come to the parliament. So parliament after debate, even I am happy, they can make an interim constitution. Because up to that, Dr. Dinesh explained how it works. Okay.
So no, you're saying that there needs to be a draft constitution
now, I think, in the
before
last stage,
in order to proceed.
Yeah. Dr. Dinesh clearly explained. Now this goes to the parliament. And 3 days or 4 days, Prime Minister said, we start a debate. At the end of the debate, at least, I'm so happy if they can come up with the interim constitution. Then another debate we can start here.
Mr. Koritoku, there has been a lot of debate on the words unitary
or the F word in politics right now, federal.
Yeah.
I like to draw attention to Europe. Going by what's happening in Catalonia, what aspects do you think lawmakers should keep in mind when they're drafting a new constitution?
That's a very important area that you should address. Take, for example, the central bank report 2015-16-17. In this country, total revenue spent on defense is 280 billion. Why? There's insecurity. The government, because the one community, the government considered that there can be a kind of uprising, and therefore they want to maintain huge, big defense force. Okay. And whereas for education, health, transport, social security, 25-30 billion for each what? For education, health, transport and social security. Whereas in the other parts of the, for example, in the UK, it's completely the other way around. Fairly high volume, larger portion of the revenue spent on health, education, transport and social security. Why we can't do that? Because the people have a kind of insecurity. People don't believe that they, for example, the Tamil minority, they don't have a confidence. So in order to give them the confidence, this is the only way this you can address this issue. That is, the devolution of power is not required at all, provided the every citizen is given their equal right, the protection and the recognition, if that is given, including the racial discrimination law has to be very strict laws, make it a very serious criminal offense. Discrimination of any citizen in any manner can be belong to any community. If that can be addressed, we can bring down the defense bill from 280 billion first year itself. You can down reduce it to 50% and spend that money.
There is no war in Sri Lanka.
No, that is the issue. There is no war.
In the security.
Yeah, that is, there is no war. Still, we spend a lot of money on this thing. Why this thing? Can you, do you think that this country can move forward with this? No, you can't. What I propose is, you have to give confidence to the people. Every citizen should be given that recognition. Every citizen should be given that, guarantee that you will not be discriminated in this country in any manner at all. Whereas, although it is not on paper, it's not obvious, it is there in this country. That's a discrimination. Tamils and Muslim communities are discriminated in this country. Our single majority may not agree, but it is there. That is why this government spends so much of money on this defense, maintain this defense. So my proposal is, this proposal is not required at all. For example, for this provincial council, to maintain provincial council, the annual bill is 82 billion. Who asked for this provincial council? If you hold a referendum tomorrow in this country, ask people, do you want provincial in the country? Do you think that people will ask? The second class politicians, they are the people who want this provincial council, not the average citizen in this country. We never asked. 1983, India who forced us to have this provincial council system. India proposed only the Northern Province provincial council, whereas the government, J.R. Jayawardene, it is for the whole nation. These issues have to be dealt with. This is why basically the primary objective of this new draft constitution is to devolve power. Tamil community do not want it, I believe, because I have my first-hand information. Tamil politicians are worse than Sinhalese politicians, because through my investigations on this permit issue, I found all TNA MPs have performed worse than the Sinhalese politicians. They have almost all sold their permits. So therefore, I can say all these politicians are equally corrupt. If Tamil politicians mislead their own people, our politicians also do the same. This country need kind of a leadership, honest, with a, I mean, credibility. We don't have such leadership. Our people are dishonest. There is no credibility. There is no honesty. There is no loyalty to this nation.
So you can give
this
the
is a fact.
No. Huh? You can give the leadership.
That is what I am trying to do. I am not expecting anything from this country.
Yeah, Dr. Dinesha, in the subcommittee reports in towards the beginning, the preamble, it says the subcommittee determined that in the formulation of a progressive and futuristic Bill of Rights, the inclusion of justiciable socio-economic rights was of paramount importance. Mm. Can you simplify this, please?
Yes. So, the current constitution, the 78 constitution, in chapter 3 recognizes certain fundamental rights. If you look at those rights, they are primarily what are known as civil and political rights.
Sure.
So freedom of expression, right to be free from torture, right to equality, etc. All the rights related to education, healthcare, social security are not recognized as rights. They are described as directive principles of state policy in a separate chapter.
And directive principle cannot, you can't go to court over.
Yes. So you can't rely on a directive principle and go to court. But following the footsteps of the Indian judiciary, the Sri Lankan judiciary have also, in certain instances, interpreted our fundamental rights in light of directive principles of state policy. And the best example we can take of that is our right to education. So our constitution does not recognize the right to education, but our judiciary has, in certain cases, argued or determined that the right to equality includes the right to access to education. Now, we have had a welfare state since independence, where health education has been provided free of charge. We've had very progressive labor legislation which protects workers, etc. But over time, as Mr. Kodithawakku pointed out, due to several reasons, including political patronage, corruption, etc., our welfare system is now not as strong as it used to be. So one way of addressing this problem is to ensure that our right to education, right to healthcare, etc., are also described as justiciable rights in a new constitution, which means you should be able to go to the judiciary claiming that your right to education, for instance, has been violated. Now, interestingly, if you look at the submissions made to the Public Representations Committee, many people have proposed that this be part of a new constitution. The disagreement on the justiciability of economic, social, cultural rights have come about through a debate between so-called experts. So, there seems to be a strong debate as to whether economic, social, cultural rights should be justiciable or not. Some experts strongly agree, while some other experts strongly disagree. And both sides are arguing based on reason.
However, Dr. Dinesh Shah, even when it comes to something like education, there are ways of going to the Supreme Court, for example, the school admission in matters.
Yes, Sonali, but that is inadequate because the only guarantee that you have is of access to education. So if the marking scheme has not been complied with, then you can go to the Supreme Court and argue that you have been discriminated against.
Okay.
You cannot challenge issues related to substantive aspects of your right to education, such as the facilities that are afforded by a school, such as the resources that are accessible. Most of our jurisprudence has been in relation to access to primary schools or access to universities.
Right. Thank you very much. Charita, you have one last question.
Dr. Mahanam, here now, there are concerns that new constitutional reforms may turn Sri Lanka into a federal state, but there is no final conclusion yet, and we haven't seen a final draft of the proposals. So, if in a situation where there is great autonomy, do you think that some states could, you know, look at the option of, you know, exiting or self-determination? Do you think that could lead to a situation of secession?
Charita, before you finish the question, just for the benefit of our viewers who may not have the interim report of the steering committee before them right now, it says here that Sri Lanka should remain one undivided and indivisible country. Maximum devolution should be granted. And in Sri Lanka, sovereignty will rest with the people and shall be inalienable and indivisible. So on that note, I think, Doctor, you can answer.
Now, I'll give a practical example. Former Chief Minister, Northern Province, Vardha Raja Perumal, unilateral declaration of Ilam. He declared at the time when Prabhakaran was fighting. But finally, was it accepted by international community? Whether it was accepted by Sri Lanka, finally he escaped from here and went to India. I mean, in the present system, president, representative is the governor. Let's see, three provincial councils now dissolved. But still they are running with the governor. I mean, we have to strengthen one thing. Now, when you are talking about this federalism or mini-federalism, these are all legal concepts. People are not aware much about that. My argument, the devolution should be there within a unitary state. Still you didn't give me the answer. In the present constitution, what is the Tamil word used for unitary? Oru mithanadu or not? Those things create, you know, doubts in the single community. That's why people come and explain these things. If you can keep the same word as she explained, Sonali, undivided, all these things, okay. And the other thing, you're asking this system. Even India is a mini federal system. It cannot separate. Even very recently, another state was set up in Hyderabad site. I can't remember the name.
Andhra Pradesh. Telangana.
It was fighting for a long time even. A lot of postgraduate committed suicide for this Telangana state. Now, Sri Lanka, geographically, is not like that. Even in Tamil people, I'll give a good example. When I was in the Human Rights Commission, I visited there. Tamil people, they come and complain that in Tamil language to Tamil officers, what's their request? Don't appoint a Tamil police officer to investigate this inquiry. So they feel it should be done by a single officer. I mean, Naga explained this very clearly. The people need not federalism, not unitary, to live in this country. Mm. But as academics, as professionals, we should lead these politicians. And I don't know, these foreign elements are actually coming and want to divide the country. Those are other sub-elements. So what we should do, we should strengthen within a unitary country more devolution. But still, executive president should be remain. If no executive president, if one state try to, one provincial council, if they try to separate, then there can be an issue. And then whether it should come to executive prime minister. Are we looking about that? There is no executive prime minister. Prime minister with the democratical system, prime minister and the cabinet. So these some of the issues.
Executive president can remain, but without the immunity. He can't.
Dr. Dinesh, your thoughts on this?
I would like to add some comments to this current discussion. On page 5 of the interim report, there's provision for safeguards against secession. And they specifically propose that no provincial council or the other authority may declare any part of the territory of Sri Lanka to be a separate state or advocate or take steps towards secession of any province or part thereof from Sri Lanka. Now, looking at experiences in different parts of the world, it seems that allowing for devolution, healthy devolution, is actually the best strategy for preventing secession. So allowing people to make their own decisions as far as possible at the lowest level of the community. This is also known as the principle of subsidiarity. But again, in the current attempts at reform, there are debates as to whether the principle of subsidiarity should be accepted as part of our constitution or not.
In that case, if it is in allowing people to make their own decisions at the lowest level of this thing, in that case, the focus of any attempt at devolution should be the local government authorities, not the provincial councils.
So, according to this report, what is proposed is that power be devolved to the provincial councils, including legislative power, as per the provincial council list, and to use the local authority as the implementing body. So that is another way of looking at how power should be shared and implementing the principle of subsidiarity. Because one of the concerns about empowering local authorities as opposed to the second tier of government, which is the provincial council, is this whole question about ethnic representation and representation of diversity. There has been, as we all know in our political history, contestations about identity, which are unresolved. One way in which there has been an attempt at resolving it is to use the provincial councils. Now, opinion is divided. I don't want to make a conclusive suggestion on that. But the provincial council system seems to be the one that most political parties do have consensus around at the moment. So that seems to be why they're going ahead with it.
But when you look at it from a point of governance, when you undertake devolution solely on the basis of ethnic considerations, and you divorce it from the most important element of governance, which is the delivery of public services, can that be considered meaningful devolution?
So my personal opinion on using ethnicity as a frame for democracy in Sri Lanka is that it's very problematic. But as much as we all hold our personal opinion, political contestation has revolved around ethnicity, and that is why we need to address it. So even this interim report addresses this question of the ethnic conflict that we have in Sri Lanka and this question of minority representation. But it does not divorce the service delivery aspect from ensuring ethnic representation. In fact, there are proposals to ensure that a public service commission be appointed at provincial level and that it functions independently. So there are proposals that are being made to ensure that service delivery is improved as well, both at the devolved level but also at the center.
In the present, for a lot of the Sri Lankan populace, myself included, from personal experience, I'm telling you, accessing public services, whether it's at the Department of the Registration of Persons, whether it's at the Department of Motor Traffic, whether it's the local police station, whether it's the municipal council, from waste collection and waste management right through to the top, accessing public services is a huge issue in this country. Let alone the bureaucratic barriers that you encounter, you also have the barriers of corruption and bribery that you encounter. In what you have seen so far in the constitution making process, are these concerns addressed? Because it appears to me that if you focus on fixing these problems with access to public services and the delivery of public services, you can also have the spillover benefit of addressing perceived tensions.
So I agree with you on your observations about the problems we experience in relation to accessing public services and also about the need to address it so that it has a greater effect. The subcommittee report on the public service does try to address it by ensuring independence of these bodies and also in trying to ensure greater accountability. But the interim report, as I said, focuses on several other aspects. So that is why the interim report itself doesn't offer any specific suggestions on that. But also, I think we need to understand the role of a constitution in any democratic society. It cannot solve all problems. In fact, law alone is not going to solve our problems. But it's definitely one powerful tool that we have. It has a normative impact. So I do think that these proposals do have the potential to make a normative impact at a foundational level, and as citizens that we could use that foundation to build a better society for Sri Lanka.
Thank you very much. On that note, we go in for our final break on the show. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Welcome back to
to face the nation. We're discussing the constitution-making process in Sri Lanka. Our final question is to Mr. Nahagananda Kodithuwakku. Mr. Kodithuwakku, you're an activist yourself.
Yeah.
And you are rather vocal and controversial sometimes when it comes to your views. Do you think, in 2 minutes, do you think that making a new constitution is Sri Lanka's next priority? Or do you think we're getting our priorities all wrong?
Yes, exactly. We got priorities wrong. The constitution, as my learned friend said, there are certain areas that we have to address. For example, judicial review has to be there. Without the judicial review, you cannot guarantee the representative democracy and the people's sovereign rights. The best example is what happened to that particular bill which was enacted last week. If there had been a judicial review, of course, the legislature shouldn't have been able to enact this law. This is what happened even in the 1988. This nationalist thing, it was enacted, I mean, not by lawful means. There was two bills. If there had been a judicial review, easily judiciary would have been able to cancel it or repeal it. And therefore, I believe there has to be the priorities. If you address the issues appropriately, the rule of law has to be established in this country. Without the rule of law, there is no point talking all these things. In this country, the rule of law has failed because the judiciary is not given the due place in this country.
Mr. Kodithuwakku, one may claim that you are rather pessimistic in your outlook. How would you respond to this? I mean,
I am so optimistic.
Can't we try to look at this progressively?
Yes. What do you mean the progressively? Because this is there are certain ulterior motives. I think that's what I said. If
what
they want, let
motives?
Them put forward
Can
the draft constitution before the people.
What do you mean
people?
By ulterior motives?
That's what I say. If there is a genuine effort, why not they put forward the draft constitution before the people? As my learned friend said, once they put forward the draft constitution, of course we will discuss it. We know there are a lot of shortcomings in the current constitution. That is why the legislature behave in this manner. They take everything into their hand. They behave like criminals. Why I say that criminals? I maintain that statement. I can prove that the lot of criminals occupying office in the legislature and the executive. We have to address this issue. We can't address this issue unless the judiciary is given in the right place.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Kodithuwakku, for your interesting thoughts. Dr. Mahana Maheva, earlier on in the discussion, you said that you have certain concerns with the fact that the interim report of the steering committee contains observations by all political parties except the United National Party, and you cast certain aspersions. What are you really saying?
The issue is this. If the parliament assemble as a constituent assembly, so United National Party, major party, their proposals are not there. So, I mean, there's a doubt. All these proposals, who peruse, who actually drafting this, so the drafter's opinion is there in this. So, don't escape from this system. You also must put it. And United National Party is the leading this constitution making. The parliamentarians are basically not from any other party. So I strongly, this is my personal view, may not agree. So I have a doubt the new constitution actually have been drafted. That's my personal view. They just put this type of committee reports, people are actually arguing. Right time, they will put the draft. So this is where 2015, when they went for the election, they had there in their mind. But still the doubt is with the two parties, how are you going to reconcile it? And my last argument is this. Good, at least 2000 participated, but we had enough opportunity to get more participation, because methodological, you know, flaws may be there. I may be wrong.
Dr. Mahanamuhiva, are you trying to say that this process is rushed?
Yes, and no more people friendly one. But the constitution must actually, even if you ask from a general public what is a constitution, they are not understanding. So that's why I am really happy given 2000 we have received. But it should be more simplified. Now see the South African constitution, a very simple one. So drafted. So most of the thing in this constitution, even lawyers cannot read and understand. So make it more simple, more friendly. So that's why my argument. And also finally, the public service, I have to say one thing. It's all about the culture. It's all about people. And we are also responsible. These criminals were elected to the parliament by us. So we also have a responsibility, even in the next election, to elect, discipline people to the parliament. Even March 13, they had all these, you know, whatever
March
the policies 12th and all.
Declaration.
But finally, what will happen? The person who are most qualified, even in the last UNP election, he got only 4,000 votes, but all these business people got that vote. So
right.
This is where political culture, as well as you have to see, to develop a culture which really respect, protect human rights, then the public service will come into that stand.
Thank you very much. Dr. Dinesha, the final question is to you. A constitution is supposed to uphold, ensure and protect the rights of all people living in Sri Lanka. How important is it for this constitution making process to then filter down to not just people who speak English or not just people in air-conditioned rooms, but to the masses? How should they engage in this process now? I know there's been a public representations committee on constitutional reform and all of that, but even to have a healthy debate on this, because this will be the supreme document that governs everyone's lives, more or less. So how do we then engage the masses?
So several responses, Sonali. One is the possibility of using the media as a platform to debate the merits of these proposals.
Right.
I think conspiracy theories abound. And we are no strangers. I mean, if you look at Sri Lanka's history, we've always had conspiracy theories about so many developments in the public sphere, and the and proposals for constitutional reform will also continue to suffer from it. So I think intellectuals, political representatives, journalists have a responsibility to bring out the merits of these proposals and debate those on the basis of the merits.
As well as the demerits.
Yes,
because
merits
ultimately we need a system which has to be cut and polished until it's perfect.
Yes. Well, I don't know whether a constitution can be perfect. No constitution is perfect. But it must be a living constitution which can continue to push society towards greater respect for human rights,
Absolutely.
Greater respect for the rule of law, and greater development of the human potential.
Right.
So that is one, and the other one is proactive education of the public, and for that the government must take responsibility if it does want to take the constitution reform process seriously. Looking back, I think the attempts made by the government between 1995 and 2000 were quite successful, in that people still remember the attempts that were made to take out the message about constitution reform to the public. So I think following that example, other models can be developed to take the message to the public. And thirdly, I think this process that is envisaged in the motion that was presented to Parliament is very transparent and accessible. So it's partly also for us to take responsibility as citizens to engage and to push our government to adopt a constitution that is better for its citizens. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Dinesha. And with that, we draw to a close this program. I'd like to thank our guests on tonight's show, Mr. Naganand Kodithuwakku, attorney at law, Dr. Dinesha Samaratna, attorney at law, and also senior lecturer at the University of Colombo, and finally, Dr. Mahana Maheva, also an attorney at law and senior lecturer at the University of Colombo. Our journalists tonight, Charitha Fernando and Nadeem Majid, thanks so much for all the fantastic questions. For all of you watching us from home, remember that sovereignty vests in you. The constitution-making process is something that impacts your life. That is why we at News First will keep monitoring this and bringing in experts on a daily basis to let you know what is going on. Thanks for joining us. Good night.